Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Good morning. Listen.
Morning.
There is a nice, happy hubbub. Can you hear me clearly? Do you need to turn me up a bit? There we go. Good morning. Do you know, there's a lovely kind of... there's a lovely hubbub of noise, of people saying hello to each other and good morning to each other. And I'd like to say an extended good morning to those folk who are on Zoom at home. Or not at home. Last week we had a Zoomer coming in from Australia, live to the service. While they were Zooming into the service from Australia, they commented that they were watching the Australian Open at the same time, and I didn't know if they were actually like there at the Australian Open in the final, like with like CSK Zoom Open. Like they're like, Mr. Djokovic, can you just please be a bit quiet? We're in a worship time. Actually, there's a kind of sense that people can be connected from all over the place. And today's service is about connectedness in a special way, about the way that God includes and involves us. So before we worship, I'm going to pray that God would work here. And he's okay there. He's absolutely fine. As long as he's comfortable. He might do a little bit of an explore. Yeah, maybe not that room. Oh. Yeah, he's found the matches, he's found the wine. Oh. Do you know, can anyone remember what it was like being that age? Everything huge around you. Do you know, I think we're like that sometimes, you know? We're sometimes like that. We just want to explore. We just want to go and find things. And actually, God, our Father, he wants to just welcome us into his wonderful world that he made for us, to share it with us. So let's just pray that God does that now. Father God, we thank you for your welcome. Lord, we thank you for your overwhelming generosity and your goodness. Lord, as we are gathered here in your name today, Father God, I pray for just a childlike wonder as we sing, as we think. Lord, may we come to you as children exploring the world, as people longing to know more about you, to know more about ourselves, and know more about each other. Lord, draw us deeper and closer into you today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand.
worship. Lord, we choose to worship you. Lord, we choose to worship. Give our all and worship only you.
Forgiveness
Victory. We live in that conquering of death and sin. And Lord, we live to claim your victory. We live to live in your victory. Lord Jesus, come now. Come now and lead us into your victory. Lord, fill this place with your power. Come and work inside us, in the very depths of us, in the fibers of our being. Transform us and renew us in your image, in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Please be seated. That's an optimistic prayer, maybe. That God, hello. It is great to have you up here with me. I might get your help later on. Do you know, we are going to be looking at a passage today from one of Paul's letters to the early church. So Paul, for those of you who don't know, was one of the first people to be following Jesus, and he was really passionate about the good news of Jesus. And he went around and shared it with loads of different people, and then wherever he went, he was like a flaming torch. And wherever he went, he left these little fires. One time I played... This is the kind of thing I did when I was a teenager. Don't judge me, please. We got a little foam tennis ball, not like a proper tennis ball, like a foam tennis ball. We filled it with, when I say we, it was me and my friends. We filled it with meths, which is like it doesn't burn super hot. It's not, so we thought it wouldn't be too dangerous. It burns with like a little light glowy flame. And we had these wooden bats, and we decided, so we got the ball filled with meths, we lit it, and we played kind of like a game of tennis. And anyway, the ball, whenever it hit our bat, it would leave a little bit of meths on the bat, which that would be burning. And it was very easy to put out. Meths burns very cold, it's all right. And then wherever it landed, it would leave like a little burning patch, which you don't have to put out with your foot. But I think Paul was like that burning ball, and as he got bounced around wherever he went, he left these burning patches, and that wasn't a bad fire. That was a good fire, warmth. We're talking this season about warmth. He left these like these burning embers, this glowing flame, and then once he moved on to the next place, once the ball had bounced somewhere else, Paul wanted to keep those fires burning. So he sent letters of encouragement, he sent letters of wisdom, he sent letters of love. He tried to correct them where they were going wrong. He tried to steer them where he thought they were going off track. So Paul kept on this desire to keep the fires going. And he'd send a church, in this place a letter, and he'd say to them, look, I've sent you this letter, but can you please send it on to the next place as well? And so the churches, they'd copy their letter and they'd send it on to the next place. And so everybody gradually, over the course of a few years, they all had copies of these different letters. Today we're looking at one of those letters to the people who lived in the church in Galatia, which is now kind of part of Turkey. So Galatia, there were these little pockets of fire, and he sent this message to them to stoke that fire. Instead of us, like we were there going around doing that with the fire, he was trying to get it going even brighter. So now we're going to look at a passage in the Bible. I'm going to read it out, but I thought that some of you have already got your Bibles open. When I say some of you, I mean Martin. It's very good. He's there already. He's all right. He's just like, which passage are we doing? And if you don't have a Bible handy, if you've got a modern phone, you can just pop in. See, it's not just Martin. It's Roger's there too. You can put into a search engine Galatians 3, Galatians 3:23, and it'll take you to the part of the Bible. A good website for translations of the Bible and looking up Bible stuff is the Bible Gateway. I find that's a really reliable, consistent, sort of solid Bible site. If you don't like websites or phones and you'd like to use paper, we've got plenty of Bibles over in the bookshelves in the corner. At this moment, do not feel embarrassed to just jump up and go and grab one. And please feel free just to step up and go and get one. And if you're wedged in by other people, get them to go and get it instead. So Galatians 3, starting at verse 23. And I'm going to read this from the New International Version. Like, the Bible's translated afresh by so many different people. Again, I find the New International Version to be one of the ones that's quite a reliable, solid translation of the ancient Greek. So here we are, verse 23 of Galatians 3. And the translators have given this part the caption, Children of God. Before the coming of this faith, we were held in custody under the law, locked up until the faith that was to come would be revealed. So the law was our guardian until Christ came, that we might be justified by faith. Now that this faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian. So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. And this is the really important part I want to emphasize today. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. And of course, that's verse 29, which wasn't on the thing that I put on the computer or on the notice sheet. So I apologize for that. But I'm going to say it again for those who didn't see it on the screen. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. I'm going to start there and work my way back, because that idea of Abraham's seed is one of Paul's central ideas. He was trying to set these people on fire with passion for the things that God was doing. But Paul was rooted in an ancient tradition, the Jewish faith, for whom the idea of Abraham was one of the most important and exciting things. And you might hear me say, The idea of Abraham was one of the most important and exciting things. And you might instantly just go like, oh, like that. You might just instantly switch off. But actually, for the people of Israel, being Abraham's children was one of the concepts that defined and shaped and inspired all that they did, because Abraham was promised to be the one who would bless, that his descendants would bless the nations, his seed would bless the nations. And so the people of Israel had this kind of like driving idea that God had made them to bless the world. And so when Paul says, if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed, Paul is saying that you are the heirs of this incredible promise to bless the nations of the world. Heirs, according to the promise. Heirs. Heirs. Who inherits? Who inherits things? Well, things are very different in 2023. We live in a different world. But at the time of Jesus and the time of Paul, the people who did most of the inheriting were the sons. So the sons were the ones who inherited. It was a society shaped by men, ruled by men, governed by men. Men were the teachers. Men had the power. Men could get away with all sorts of things that women could not get away with. And so, going back to verse 28, Paul is now declaring, there is no male or female. You are all heirs of the promise of Abraham. Those massive long lists in the Old Testament of this person, son of that person, son of that person, son of that person, all the men listed and the very rarely a woman listed. All of the story of the deeds of men and the deeds of a couple of women, like on the side, but mostly it was the men, the kings, the prophets, the lawgivers, the rulers were the men. But Paul, sharing the good news of Jesus, says, now, with Jesus, there is now no male nor female. You are all one in Christ Jesus. You are all heirs of the promise of Christ. And I mentioned the idea of the Jewish people, and so this was a Jewish kind of thing, being heirs of the promise of God, the promise made to Abraham. So you are all heirs of this promise. The Jewish people said, no, this is what's been made. This promise has been made to us. This is to our people. It's kind of like a little closed circle. There's a wall. And actually, if you want to get into the promise, you've got to climb over the wall and get in and become part of the Jewish people. Some demanded circumcision. And so the first disciples of Jesus were all Jewish. The 12 apostles, Jesus himself, the crowds who followed, there would be the occasional centurion or the occasional woman from Phoenicia. Like, you'd get these occasional people, but the vast body of the first followers of Jesus were Jewish. Jesus kind of like sneaked out of Israel just on a couple of occasions as he went, like, maybe for some fish and chips by the beach in Tyre and Sidon. One time when he was taking a little shortcut through Samaria. But Jesus didn't like go off on some massive long missionary trek around all of the nations of the world. He was a homeboy. He stayed in his local place mostly. He stayed in his local place with local people. And it could be very easy. It could be very easy for the first followers to go, no, this is still a Jewish thing. This is us. This is our kind of like little closed shop. But Paul said, no. Can't you see the message of Jesus that he told you to take to Samaria, to the ends of the earth, to Jerusalem and Judea first, the local place, but then beyond, Can't you see the way that Jesus interacted with this person who everyone thought was unclean? He interacted with that person who everyone thought was like part of an empire and separate. Can't you see the way that Jesus interacted with the people? This message is not just for the Jewish people. No, now there is neither Jew nor Gentile. And so the Gentiles were the non-Jews, which I think most of us would be in that category. And the Jews are the people of Israel. And Jesus shared that message in his time. But Paul said, no, you've got to make sure you understand this. It's not just the people of Israel in Judea who are the heirs of the promise of Jesus. It's Jew and Gentile. It's male and female. And there's another idea in here that is quite profound as well. The world at the time was divided along lots of kind of like boundaries, so male or female. The men inherited, the women kind of like tagged on the coattails of the men. The Jewish people thought they had all the answers, and they thought that the Gentile people didn't. And so there was exclusion that way. But there was also this horrific and all-pervasive structure in society of slavery. There were people who were free people, some of whom were citizens of the country or citizens of Rome, and they had standing. They could live free lives. They could make their own choices. But slaves were property. Slaves were like items. Slaves were like a lectern that just does what it's told. It can't choose where to go. I can't even begin to imagine the horror of slavery. I cannot even get my head around how one person could enslave another. But us flawed and messed up humans, it's one of the habits that over the centuries we've got into, of just considering other people inhuman almost. Slavery, objectifying. And so there's this kind of like ancient evil in humanity of one person with power enslaving somebody else who is weak. And their society was divided along that lines. People were citizens, they were free people, or they were slaves. Slaves owned. They had no choice, no direction, no control. Slaves or free. And Paul says, no, that's no longer a dividing line. Whatever your status in the world, you have one status in Jesus' kingdom, which is child of God. And I think another thing that happened in the church then, in the early days, and it's mentioned in the letters written by James, Peter, and Paul, one of the things that happened in those days is that actually there were first-class citizens and second-class citizens. So in James talks about, James was probably the brother of Jesus. It's not entirely clear to say. James wrote one of the other letters in the New Testament. He was writing about how the rich were getting all of the kind of like attention. They were getting special places when the church gathered. How the rich were being like given a special seat. And James said how wrong that is. You can't make the rich first-class citizens and the poor second-class citizens. Paul here is saying you can't say that the men are the first-class citizens and the women are the second-class citizens. There's this human thing that we divide ourselves off, that we kind of separate out. And sometimes that's healthy. And it's good. For example, and you might be able to think of examples of this for yourself in your own life. Once a month, a very lovely group of people separate themselves out from the rest of society and gather in the hall to compare their quilts. They're quilters. They make quilts, very lovely quilts. I've seen a few of them and I chat to them occasionally. They're a really lovely bunch, but they are quilters. So sometimes we separate ourselves off to do something special. We meet with people who have like ideas the same as us, who think the same as us. And that's a really healthy and wholesome and good thing to do. But Paul says the church of God shouldn't be like that. The church of God should be inclusive and welcoming. It should be open to everybody, whatever their status. And here, I see that lived out in us, in this community. This is a church that's not one race or one culture. This is a church that is a mix of all sorts of people, all sorts of status. We don't make anybody in here first-class citizens. There's nobody here who's a second-class citizen, I don't think. Us humans, we kind of slip into those patterns sometimes. But actually here, in the body of Christ, we want to embody. We want to incarnate that inclusivity, that welcome. And we want to emphasize that there is no first and second class citizen in the kingdom of God. We are all one in Christ Jesus. We are all one in Christ Jesus. And within the body, there are people with different roles and different functions and different gifts and different callings. That within the body, that there's so much variety. But within that varied, creative, interesting body, we are all one. Paul drove it home in a few different places in his letters. If we go back to verse 26, and at the beginning of this service, we had a little child running around, and we had another little child sitting up here, and we've got a little child in some arms here. I've forgotten her name. Anna Maria. Children are a gift. Children are a gift. Children are a joy. That's you. You are the gift. You are the joy. You are the treasure. You are the wonder. And yeah, we also know that children mess up and make mistakes and say things that insult somebody else and pinch a toy when they shouldn't do and get grumpy towards the end of the day when they're tired. That's us. That's us, isn't it? We mess up. We make mistakes. Being the children of God means that we're heirs of the promise, but also we recognize that actually He is the Father and we are the children. And I see sometimes in schools, I sometimes see children who look like they have been left out of the group. Do you know, maybe you're lucky and you've always been included. You've always been welcomed into the center. Maybe you're lucky like that, but I don't think that's everyone's story. I think a load of us, we know what it's like to be outside the center. We know what it's like to feel like we're outside of the circle. We know what it's like to see like everyone else huddling and be left on the sidelines. Did you ever get picked last? Did you ever get picked last in a game in the schoolyard when the captains were picking people and like they didn't want you for whatever reason? And you're left on the edge. Well, the kingdom of God is not like that. The kingdom of God's not like that. All are welcomed in. All are welcomed in. And one last thing about that, and I think this is a potentially controversial and potentially emotional subject. But the Church of England right now is wrestling. Different groups within the Church of England are wrestling with the idea of sexual identity. So if you read some headlines this week, you'll see that bishops are really divided about how to understand and think about who can be blessed in God's church in marriage and who can't. And some bishops and vicars and archbishops think one thing, and some bishops and vicars and archbishops think another. And within churches, some congregation members think one thing, some congregation members think another, and some people in the middle just go, oof, I don't know. I want to come back to the idea that is a driving and overwhelming and powerful idea for me personally, is that the first point for the kingdom of God is this message of Paul's. That there is no slave nor free, Jew nor Gentile, male nor female. I personally do not want to discriminate between people because of who they are. I don't want to say, well, okay, you're in the kingdom, you're not in the kingdom. I would like to have an open table, a welcoming table. And I don't know what that fully looks like. I feel like I look at the broad church that is divided and confused, and I see that reflected in myself. I don't know exactly what the truth is. You might like to have a vicar who says, nope, I know all of the answers, and I know exactly what we should do, and I'm going to give you every explanation for every single thing you would like to know about. That's not how reality works. But if it is, you'll get a vicar who gets a lot of things badly wrong, I think. Paul knew that these questions were hard, and he wrestled with them, that there was this driving, wrestling kind of question early on in the church about, should new Christians be circumcised? Should new Christians be circumcised? And of course, that goes for the men. Women were fine. The women are just there going, I don't mind, I'm perfectly fine with circumcision. For you men. Paul wrestled with these things and the implications of them over decades with other people, and the church had these factions in the early days that just wrestled with each other, the tension between them. But Paul kind of re-emphasized this thing. We are all one in Christ Jesus. There is no Jew nor Gentile, circumcised nor uncircumcised. Those, and just go back to verse 26. So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who are baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. That is us, one body. And the hard part then is figuring out how we live together, how we walk together, how we journey together. That's the hard part. And it requires relationships and friendships. It requires conversations. It requires sometimes disagreements because we think different things, but actually we hold those together in that knowledge that we are one in Christ. And I'd like to just do communion today a little bit differently. Not much differently. Do you know the bit from the beginning of the Gospel of John, where John writes in the Gospel, he sort of talks about the incarnation of Jesus, which means Jesus becoming flesh, becoming man. And he uses a phrase that Jesus came and made his dwelling among us. The original language is like pitching a tent. So he pitched his tent. And there's just kind of a sense in which That's the story of Jesus' life. He didn't exclude himself from us. He came and lived with us in inclusion. He wasn't far away and distant and inaccessible. He didn't restrict himself to living in a temple. He came and lived among us. And he included himself in other people's lives. And he included himself, he included other people in his life. He included the people who were thought of as rejects from society. He included the people who were thought of as being cursed. He lived with people. And that's how we're called to live as his people. So, we're going to do the communion prayer in a couple of minutes. The band are going to come and lead us in a song, during which I think it'd be great to think about how have you been included? How have you been welcomed in? And then how can you include? And how can you welcome? How can you make people welcome? How can you include? How can you receive the promise and give the promise? Let's worship God. As we're able. Speaking of inclusivity, there's one thing just ahead of sharing communion together. Is there anybody here who's gluten-free? Because I know that actually that's something that can exclude people from... If we do have any gluten-free people, do let me know. Nope. Good. Good. Thank you. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ, you shared our life that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it. And he gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit, that this bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. And that song is the song that's described in Revelation, the song that is sung by a choir of the thousands, the millions, the billions, the nations, the cultures, the tongues, all united in the song of praise of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. United in praise of Christ, united in purpose, welcomed and included. So together we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Amen. turn myself back on again. Please take a seat. We're going to have two stations to deliver communion, one over this side, one over here. Speaking about inclusion, the way the Church of England works is that the Church of England offers communion not just to people who are members of the Church of England, but if you are a follower of Jesus, if you have been baptized and you've made that choice to follow him, you are welcome to come and receive at the Lord's table. It's the Lord's table, not mine, or not the Church of England's. And with that in mind, if you want to come and you don't want to receive bread and wine, you can come and put your hands out like that to receive the bread and the wine, which we give by dipping the bread into the wine and handing to you. But if you'd like to not receive communion but receive a blessing, just come with your hands down and we'll pray a prayer of blessing over you, just a simple one, it won't take long. Like a little prayer over this little beautiful one here. That's a baby I'm pointing at, by the way, not a lady. But Jesus included people by saying that I'm giving my life for you so that you may receive my life. That's what we celebrate and remember here today. I'm going to give the bread and wine to the band first, and then somebody will direct you to come and receive. Make the body of Jesus broken for you. Pavan, the body of Jesus broken for you. The body of Jesus broken for you. The body of Jesus broken for you. Josh, may God bless you with all of his strength and power, courage and might. Let it shine from you every day in Jesus' name. Amen. The body of Jesus broken for you. The body of Jesus broken for you. The body of Jesus broken for you. The body of Jesus broken for you.
gave me this breath, and you gave me the strength, and every day I live to obey you with all of my heart, with all of my soul. Let every breath I'm breathing display
is who you are. You are Waymaker, Miracle.
is who you are. That 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 is who you are.
And so the disciples, they were left after the resurrection with the empty wrappings left in the middle of them, but they were left with a message of power and hope and encouragement. And as we receive the body of Christ, we are then empowered to go and share. Do you know, when I leave church, I have no idea who I'm going to meet in the next 7 days. Got some meetings planned, got some groups and things I'll be going to, but I don't know who I'm going to take the message of Jesus to, and I don't know if you do either. This week, in your week, it might be a completely normal week for you, but it might be something that just shares the inclusion of God with somebody else. So I'm going to pray now that, filled with the body, filled with the lifeblood of Jesus, we're going to go from here, not just into a boring week, but into a week when we bounce like balls of fire through this community, sharing the light and warmth and fire of God. Let's pray. Lord, you draw us in. You gather us. You welcome us and you include us. And you share yourself with us in ways that are too profound for us to even know. Lord, filled with you, may we go from here like warm, glowing balls of fire that share your warmth, that share your welcome, that share your inclusion wherever we go. Lord, may your love fill us and fire us. And may you send us out in your power. In Jesus' name. Amen. Shall we stand and praise in one last song?
Thank you.
great is our God, and all will see how great, is our God.
So Lord, may we go here, go from here, carrying your fire within us. May we carry with us a message of love and peace, a message of power, a message of hope. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us and those we love this day and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen. But before you go, do have a cup of coffee or tea. Chat to somebody, say thank you to the tech team who did an amazing job at the back. Say thank you to Josh who did some fantastic drumming this morning. Say, have a great week. Bless you.